Hello, welcome back. Welcome to another episode of Sunday School is Cool. This is episode 14, part two of Wisdom, but its own episode. Maybe a quicker one. Probably, but I don't know. I can croon or whatever. I just yak and yak and go on. Everybody knows that. What are you going to do? But anyway, we got nothing to do anyway. And I like this, so I'm going to do it. Makes me happy, and plus, I understand I'm supposed to do it. It's on my mind right now, it's in my heart, and I'm not hurting anyone. I'm not the one doing that. In fact, I seem to report, hey, wait a minute. But, you got it. But, so do a lot of people that try to help. I even understand that. But then, get out of here. Toast. Bunch of toast. Good for being toast. Anywho, last time was the Wisdom of Solomon and the Proverbs. And it's just some of them. And really. Anyway, what we're going to do now is go through James. James the Just, who can say. We're going to read a little study Bible intro here. And then we're going to just read it. We're just going to read it. It's not a long book. Solomon, he had much, much to say about this and that, but James did not. He was a bondservant of Jesus Christ, and that's how he introduces himself. He certainly didn't introduce himself as the brother of Jesus, although verbatim, he was his brother. His mom was Mary, and his dad was Joseph. Same as Jude. The second to last book of the Bible. The last useful one. No, really. I don't think the Apostle John takes offense, all right? Because you seem to forget about his gospel or his letters in lieu of just booky revelation. You know, just booky. And then you don't even know how to interpret it. No, really. Okay. But before I even get into James, just one little thing of wisdom from Jesus. You know, even Confucius agrees. Do you know, do unto others as you would have them do unto you? Well, I think they would like, if I were them, I would want them to kick me when I'm down. Okay. All right. But then, you know, if anyone makes fun of you or makes you even look uncool because you're not cool, even a little bit, I hate you. And we'll write and repeat. The only thing on the minds of the Facebook community, the grown-ups in particular, is, you know, I just gotta look my image. I gotta look cool. I'm cool, right? You know, I'm cool. That person made me look cool. I hate you. Got it. Must be fair. Must be nice, right? With the collusion, the PayPal, and all the ting-chings. Right? No, I know about stuff, Lily or whatever. No, really. Guarantee it. People can tell me from time to time, but then it doesn't, hey, wait a minute. Anyway, it does say, you know, don't sue the brethren. You ain't brethren, pal. And I don't want to sue you. I'm tout forgiveness day. I mean, really. If I endure or survive this, right, which I'm planning on it, so public is coming, I know that. God will get you yield. You will make peace. But he's just like that. No, he'll prove it. You know how you prove the spirit's done, but like you're garbage? You know, the Baal demon stuff or whatever with the idols? Well, when you do that, you're not supposed to do that. Demons cheat. Well, then it's fair for him to cheat back because he likes faith, not knowledge. But if you're going to do that, he's not going to leave them orphan. Not once. Jesus, I will not leave you orphans. I'll send the helper. That's God. God's spirit. I'll send him. You'll see. And he's going to pour it out. I even know because for the Bible tells me so. Even Isaiah, the Old Testament one. You can't lawyer it, Hob and Aguila, and that's good news. Except the ones that don't like that, I think it's Baal. Oh, okay. Must be Jewish, right? Well, by heritage. Yeah, but read your Old Testament. Lots of them were like that. What happened to them? Well, according to the, the book of the kings of Israel, yeah, that book was lost. Now we found, 33 Club, or whatever. You know, the Knights Templar were good. Pal, Friday the 13th is one of the happiest days for Barney. He loves it. Do you know why? And even the Freemasons used to understand, no, we hated them, the Knights Templar. No, we don't descend from them like the Remnant maybe, but like, no, we hated them. That's why they encoded 13 into everything. To remind people just how much they are thrilled what happened to those shysters. It wasn't just King Louis wanted money back. Who stole it to begin with? Who turned evil? They even seemed to mock it in the little documentaries about, now there's a rumor they spit on the cross and urinated and did all the demon stuff, but we don't know about that. Pal, they turned evil. They were evil. All the Crusades. I mean, God, of course it was the Christians' fault. Certain Muslims were quite violent, too, because, you know, love and peace and all that stuff. But really, just monotheism. But no, really, I mean, you know, you're going to prove to I don't know. There's all this stuff. Maybe I'll get into it at the end, but I doubt it. This is just about James and wisdom. There's two kinds of wisdom. We're going to get into it. All right, so that's my little intro there. And really, you can use logic and reason and wisdom. You know, atheist brain or human brain, not like, do I look cool, brain? I have to agree with you, Ryan. Excuse me? A person is smart. People are stupid, and you know it. And that wisdom comes from Men in Black. But then, hey, wait a minute. If that's true. Well, I mean, the club of the Men in Black is a home run, Liam Neeson, whatever. Right, full blah, pal. Take care, man. We're all just human here. No one is inherently just great. Particularly not an actor, right? Even a human. But now you all seem to be actors. You know, let's be natural, please. Do-do-do-do. Yeah, little did they realize back then. Happy days can reappear. So can photography. Secret shystery ones. Anyway, you know, something about it. Let's get into it. Let's get into James. I could give you all the logic and reason as to writing on the wall. You know, I even posted the Freedom Paradox, you know, the one of the groups I'm in, and then they go away. Why? But anyway, what a paradox. Hey, wait a minute. I can't even point out how about my stuff? I'll take it down. All right, I'll repost it. Why did you just post it again, but like, you know, for more followers and worship to occupy Democrats or whatever, when you're not a Democrat. I'm essentially a Democrat. They don't buy it. I'm liberal. I can't stand them. But I know plenty of good, well-meaning Republicans that are socially liberal these days. Really, you try and act like people on the sides, you know, Democrats and Republicans are so different. When no, not once. No, maybe they used to be in Lincoln's day, but not even. But we're all American here. And now you collude with each other. You know, it's cool to be extreme to the left, and then you, what are you going to say, extreme man on the right? Oh, yes, I like that. And I'll say this, perfect, and then we'll act like we hate each other. You know, use the spirit of, you know, native tongue lying and deceit, you know, the spirits or whatever. I prefer the spirit of wisdom. And that's just part of God's Holy Spirit. God's spirit. Solomon refers to it as a her, she. Her, she's more precious than the many jewels or whatever. Yeah. Because, well, right. If you have that, but you, there are two kinds of wisdom. So we'll get into it. James, that's my intro. Now I'm going to read the study Bible intro. It's not that long, and I'm just going to read it. It'll be about a 45 to an hour long lesson, and well.
I hate you.
That's,
yes, hate you.
No, I got it. No, I know that.
He's the damn how I've heard it well.
Oh, the crap. No, I'm not. Not once, pal. Just a normal person here. Isn't that you?
Yes. Simply based on idols.
You better watch it with those owls, all right? You understand, provoke the Almighty to anger. You know, the Omnipotent One.
That's us. We're all seeing with the... what's the hard drive say when we replay bang? Oh, okay, Heathcliff. And you know what people are thinking, too, right? With the Ephraim Cowan thing? Oh, Ryan. We link up. Oh, you broke the chain. You broke the covenant. En masse. You all did. Quest to find faith in man unkind. Greedy, needy, must we have more? But then that guy, what do you mean, must we have more? Well, why can't you do anything about it? Really? And where is he? I don't know. Then his troubles are over, my friend. If it is, but if not, what are you doing? What are you doing? Really? But in the end, I understand, pal. No, heaven is for real. That's true. The reason they hate Christianity in particular is because, well, what did Jesus say? Hell is for real, too. That should be the sequel. Hell is for real, too. You can make it like Mortal Kombat line. Really? I would do it. No problem. Hitler, all the shysters. Anyway, you don't want to wind up there. Why? He even says, turn and live. I don't want that for you. And the apostles in the New Testament seem to agree. They don't contradict. Jesus came to fulfill the law. He said, in the past, eye for an eye, tooth for an eye. I tell you the truth, turn the other cheek. That's his wisdom. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your mind and all your soul, all your strength. That's it. Love your enemy. Do good to those who spitefully use you. Turn the other cheek. Walk with them 2 miles. Because that's your neighbor. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, it's good for nothing. And don't cause little ones to stumble. Don't teach them to be bad and sneaky. Even whatever, many an atheist are much better people who don't realize they're on an e-ticket up if they just didn't turn or just don't. Whatever, if faith is a gift you have yet to receive, that's fine. That ain't it. But if you have fervent love for one another, but people say there's not even a such thing as sinning. So you're saying you're perfect, you've not messed up or done anything, one thing bad to a person or hurt their feelings even once, or even like everyone understands that that's a bunch of BS. Now, why did I swear so much in the last episode, 13 in particular? Because it was the wisdom one. Then you can cast a stone at me and say, I gotta remove the pain. But then what did I say in episode 12 or 11 or whatever it was? Yeah, well, right. I even understood I was doing it. I'm not going to swear once. I'm going to try not to. Because in the other ones, you even understand. No, with this, I try not to. I understand kids might be watching. But then, wait a minute. Something about kids and, like, watching? And behind my back stuff? And marching them out there and in the Hawthorne, New Jersey there on Warburton? At 7, 8 years old, to go, beak, beak, whatever. Yeah, because I taught them how to swear, because the parents, right? And you're not doing sneaky stuff where you tape me behind my back. That I've been complaining about verbatim. Something about it. Been told this verbatim. Doing your now show. But wait a minute, what about, I don't like it. I've been told this verbatim. Wait a minute. They did do that? Yeah, you know, but they know nothing. They know nothing. Anyway. I don't know, my phone's hacked, all the stuff, plays music back on its own accord, and all the crazy stuff. Why? No, you're nuts. But I speak true. You would even know. There's nothing special about me except you picked me to be the poor bastard in some thing. And I have a twin sister, so I bet I have a twin sister. It's mean. Not pretty like her, but that's all right. She's not getting any younger. Sorry. Anyway, at least not as old as Gianna. Something about it. I'll hold my tongue. I don't know. Woman vexes me. But Natalie Portman's all right by me. Whoever she might be, okay? Even Carrie Fisher's all right. You can see a really good picture of her in the, if you guys have the booklet there of the first 6 movies, like the collection with all the 6 in the booklet there. If you go to the very back where everybody's on the picture and the art there, just look at Carrie Fisher. Everyone else is painted, it's the actor, but look at Carrie Fisher. It's a little joke. It's not her. It's just some other woman.
That's even funny. I even understand with empathy, like, that was probably, no, you don't have the right to do that. Or just impress me, George, with who you draw on my stead. And if you read Wishful Drinking, she's not particularly thrilled with Star Wars in general. Why? Who can say? But I don't know. I wish she would have made it to the ninth episode, but still haven't seen it. Not planning on it. No, really, I don't care. 8 was enough. Pal, you turned your back. Mark Hamill is right. We fundamentally disagree. Are you kidding me? Oh, no agenda here, no agenda. I could get into it. Maybe I'll even do a little podcast and interpret Star Wars, the new one versus the old one. Where instead of teaching and following and being true to what came before it, you just try to bastardize and ruin it with the quickness. With the quickness. I don't even, I don't know, I heard some stuff. Well, you're going to bring back Palpatine. You're going to bring back Maul. Yeah, you know, they can bring, or they never even, come on, pal. Kids are making these movies. Kids are writing these movies. And they're in charge because of oppression and intimidation. Probably gunpoint. Anywho. It's disgusting. Well, you know, you don't want to do it with collusion. You're gonna lose that. Yes, yes, you're gonna lose that clout. You're gonna lose the company and the clout. The clout. Disney will be fine, but the people in charge. Pal, you better watch it. I'd settle for a dollar if I were you with a lot of people, but I can only speak for me. Big old Barney's scheming. He's gonna plunder. But not for like, you know, the global new world where it's all one country or whatever, or anarchy. It's not anarchy, it's freedom. You're stupid. Anarchy? We don't need that. That's this. You even know. Antifa, you're toast. You little coward. All right, so with that, here we go. The Epistle of James. 15, 17 minutes in, whatever it is, I don't care. That's my intro to the intro. And now, here we go. I'll even put the little thing on. Doo-doo-doo. Or maybe I'll just do that. Okay, the intro to James. Here we go. From fixing a car to wallpapering a bedroom, how-to books explain how things are done with helpful pointers and colorful illustrations. The Epistle of James is the how-to book of the Christian life. It is one of the most practical books in the New Testament because it offers instruction and exhortation to Christians who are experiencing problems, as all of us do. As if the trials themselves were not bad enough, James points out the dangers that come with them. Besides the obvious pitfall of failing to place our trust in the Lord, and thus not enduring, James speaks of prejudice, improper speech, judging one another, leaving God out of our plans, and even bitterness. Like the author of a how-to book, James explains in a few words the responsibilities of a Christian, while supplying apt illustrations from real-life categories such as shipping and horseback riding. All right. And where did he get so much wisdom from? Well, number one, the spirit of wisdom, you can grab it for yourself. But number two, he was Jesus' brother. But we don't know for a fact, so we're going to read the rest. Author and date. Trust me, it's abundantly clear. And even if it would be, we were silly. The author of this epistle identifies himself with the phrase James, a bondservant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, implying they're two different people. Of God, you know, Yahweh, and of the Lord Jesus Christ. Gets that clear. James is a common name in the New Testament. The accompanying phrase could have described any Christian, suggesting that this particular James must have been a church leader who needed no further introduction. Four men named James are mentioned in the New Testament. One, James, the son of Zebedee and brother of John, a disciple of the apostle and disciple of Christ. That's one of the sons of thunder. James, the son of Alphaeus, see Matthew 10, verse 3, called the less or the younger. I mean, he's younger than the other James. James the younger. Also, one of the apostles. There were two apostles named James, just like there were two Judases. But yet, the book of Jude was not written by either of them. It was Jesus' brother Judas, or Jude. Let's call him dude. You know, Obama, I guess go Barack, go by Steve. By Steve. And hey, wait a minute. You better be a Republican, but wait a minute. You better be. Because God will know. So would other people in secret. Savvy. So that's the second James. It could have been James the Younger. 3, James, the father of an apostle named Judas. See Luke 16, 6 verse 16. That's the father of Judas. Probably maybe Iscariot, or maybe you know the other one. The one who, let's call him the Greek one, right? And, or 4, James, the half-brother of Jesus. Traditionally called the Just. James, the Just. Because wisdom and justice and some kind of correlation. See Matthew 13, verse 55. He became the leader of the Jerusalem church. He became the leader of the Jerusalem church. See Acts 15, verse 3, or Galatians chapter 2, verse 9. And seems to be the most probable author of this epistle. If he was the author, it is noteworthy that he did not mention his relationship to Jesus in this letter. Instead, his sole claim to authority was his spiritual servanthood to the Lord Jesus Christ and to God. See verse 1, you know, in chapter 1. You know, James, a bondservant, we'll read it. Though not universally agreed upon, the evidence is strong that James is one of the oldest books in the New Testament. Since the letter contains no specific reference to time or events that would indicate a particular date, one must consider the Jewish tone of the letter and the letter's accurate reflection of the general situation found in the early apostolic church, you know, after Jesus with the apostles. Many scholars assign a date somewhere between AD 44 and 62. Plus, he's all over Acts. The date is the time when James became the leader of the Jerusalem church, taking Peter's place after he was released from prison in the year Herod Agrippa I died. See Acts chapter 12, verse 5 through 23. The second date is given by Josephus, the first century Jewish historian, for the martyrdom of James. In the end, an early date of around AD 46 seems reasonable for this letter. Recipients. I thought Josephus is not one. He doesn't mention Jesus. Well, he doesn't mention John the Baptist or any of the apostles or anything, right? Hey, wait a. Slow. Okay. Why did they? And then they even try and bury David, you know, in their own heritage. Not really. Some do that. Why? And yet you don't know about the cow. Let me pour you a little wine from the old county. Oh, yes, the old county. Boom. Cheers. And nothing else with spirit stuff that do it, right? Right? And buggly booze, they're not around. What are you, crazy? Even if not, then how much less would you... Wait, slow. Okay, so that's the author. Recipients. The salutation identifies the reader of James as, quote, as the readers of James as, quote, the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. Some believe this letter was directed to all Jews living outside of Palestine, including both Christians and non-Christian Jews. This seems unlikely, however, since James identifies himself as a follower of Christ and refers to his readers as a community of believers. See James, basically. Others hold that the salutation is a figurative reference to all Christian churches. Well, right. Represented symbolically by ancient Israel. Just anyone who would listen. This, too, is improbable, though. Wait a minute. Since the letter contains recognizable Jewish elements, I don't think... I think you people overthink it. He was writing to this one, pal. Just read it instead of your expertise here. There is also a third possibility that the readers were Jewish Christians living outside of Palestine. Yeah, well, he did write to... Listen, whoever he was writing it to, like, I think he was just trying to help. Really? Since this letter was a circular letter that was passed from church to church because they understood who the heck's writing in here. Jesus, brother. Whoa. No specific geographical destination is pinpointed. Most of the recipients seem to have been poor and suffering from oppression imposed by their fellow Jews among whom they were living. People like Paul, also the Romans. Just whoever would listen.
He's writing to Jews, being, you know how like Saul tried to kill other Jews who believed in Jesus? Yeah, right. Like that. That's anti-Semitic. Oh, okay, that is right. But then you and, well, it's anti-love too, right? Where do we read the letter? Evidently, some of these Jewish Christians, you'll put your faith in this, but you won't read the book. The little book James wrote with the wisdom there. Evidently, some of these Jewish Christians had been imprisoned and deprived of their possessions and livelihood. Yeah, the early church got slaughtered. Under such conditions, they fell into the clutches of worldliness, fought among themselves, favored the rich over the poor, and lost their original love for one another. Theology. The Epistle of James is more practical than doctrinal. All right. Nevertheless, James contains theological statements. God is, quote, the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation, unquote, meaning that he is creator and is unchangeable. Jesus is, quote, the Lord of glory, unquote, a reference to Jesus' deity. James asserts that Jesus is coming again, and when he does, he will judge all of humanity. We'll see. Maybe he will. Chapter 5. That's the last chapter of it. Does that mean, pal, he already said, Jesus said for himself, no, God has given it to me to judge. He's not going to judge, and if you read the Old Testament, I mean, there's something where you're already doomed, all right? All it is backing up what's already written by prophets of yesteryear. They were quite Holy Spirit prophets. Now everyone can get drunk on it, particularly the early church, at least according to our Christian Bible with the New Testament. I don't care. Listen, we don't care what you believe, if you're an atheist or just an agnostic. I'm not, advocate for what the Christians do, not once. Not en masse. The exclusionism, the elitism, the you're a sinner, but I'm not. But yet, what Jesus tried to fight against, and even if you read Matthew or Luke, clearly what they were complaining about, like those ones, like the early church before organized religion took hold. I don't want to bother with it. But the major, there's nothing wrong with going to a church and fellowshipping with people. That ain't it. But, pal, a little too religious. Even you Protestants, you're way too religious and secretive. You know, you got to, with the cult thing, shut up. Well, okay. Just bashed him. You got to bash him in secret. And we don't know to his face. They say, how are you? Good luck. But they don't mean it. It's just true. But the major theological issue in James is faith and works. Many contend that James is talking about true faith versus false faith. Well, we're going to read it for ourselves, right? But it seems apparent that James is not questioning whether the recipients were genuine believers. What? Who can say? We didn't read it yet. He repeatedly calls them brethren, or my beloved brethren. These are clearly people who were exercising saving faith. Thus, what James is discussing is faith that is alone, meaning without works. He calls faith without works, quote, unquote, dead, indicating that it was faith that was once alive. Works is a natural result of faith. When a person truly believes in something, he or she will act on that belief. Thoughts and prayers don't matter, but really, if you have a belief in, like, you got to do the right thing, you don't just say it. All those people who even say that, but they keep their trap shut and don't know anything, except, we get the thoughts to groupthink. Because where's their heart at? Where are their works? What is their fruit? Terrible. Just like the people they supposedly hate, you know, these Christians. And they collude with Harun and Lum, no one knows nothing. And hey, PayPal, one person. Oh, I'm certain. Not enough space or something, right? Who can say? It's disgusting. For James, work is a natural result of faith. When a person truly believes in something, he or she will act on that belief. With this letter, James was sounding a wake-up call to all Christians. Get your life in line with what you believe. Don't be some hypocrite. And you're not perfect, pal. Wait a minute. Perfect? Paul, who did more for the church, more than most, all right? You see, he was one man.
He was flawed. He was sexist towards women. He even admitted it. I do not permit women to speak in my church. He even wrote that in a different book, but he didn't say, like, you can't. He just said, I don't. He even knew he was flawed. In Romans, he wrote, what I want to do, I can't do, but what I don't, that I do. Who can save me from such myself? Praise be to God, you know, that our Lord Jesus Christ. I find a law. He was very transparent. He was not perfect. Didn't know it all. He was. You have no empathy. You don't even read verbatim. That's why we put Jesus' words in a different color and no one else's in the Bible. He was different. He didn't say that once. He never once said anything that they're lesser people. In fact, all he said is, if you're a man and you're a believer or you have fervent love for one another, I will know that you're my disciples. He said that in general. But amongst his disciples who he was speaking to, the family came to bother him there when he was in Nazareth, dinner or whatever, he said, you know, whoever does the will of my Father in heaven, that is my brother or my sister and mother. Because if you're a woman, he understands, no, you have leg up, meek, whatever. But just in terms of, like, he's certainly not one sex. He's his ultimate feminist, even Lao Tzu. Even a person who can be a man could be a feminist. Even a person who's a diehard feminist is just a rotten sexist a lot of times. It's particularly now when they don't notice and they keep the trap shut and hate Wiccanism. Because, you know, the boys or the girls, that's the wizards. Wait a minute. Hermione was a Christian who celebrated Christmas, stupid. You're a muggle who doesn't even know the one God. Verbatim. Christ in the scriptures, last little bit here. Well, compared to the New Testament writers, James says little about Jesus. Very little, that's the point. He begins his book referring to the Lord Jesus Christ and anticipates the coming of the Lord, but that's about it in terms of direct references. Still, James's message is virtually saturated in Jesus' teachings, and well, why? He grew up with the man. Brother, verbatim. The Sermon on the Mount in particular figures prominently into James' thinking with multiple indirect references to that most famous of Jesus' sermons. Chapter 1, verse 2 is based on Matthew 5 through 12 and is connected to Matthew 5 and all the stuff, whatever. Through his teachings, James presents Jesus as one who insists that the righteousness of his followers exceed that of the Pharisees. Then there's a little outline there, which we won't need because we'll just read it verbatim. That's your first half hour. That's my intro to my intro plus my intro to James. And we'll be right back in a flash. And then, really, it's not that long. It's 5 chapters. I'm not going to chime in that much because let his wisdom speak for himself. And he is just so wise and so little bit. That'll be about an hour, hour, 10 minutes, and well. Do, 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 do. And that's it. That's my outline, all right? I'm just going to read it verbatim, all right? It's one of my favorite books, particularly chapter 1, verse 5 through 8. It's just full of wisdom. Savvy. And even if I go into it slow, it's an hour, I don't care. We're just stuck here anyway. Anyway, back in a flash, boo-boo-boo. Alrighty, y'all. And we're back for part 2 of episode 14. This is the verbatim we just read, the authorized version of James. Here we go. This is a letter he wrote to who can say. He addresses it to, he'll say. But you understand, he's writing it to anyone who would listen. That's the truth. This is Jesus' brother. Raised by Mary and Joseph. Not a perfect man. But out of the four brothers, okay, and a couple of the bratty sisters, but they were all right. I don't know. Something. Here we go. Frog mode. Here we go. This is, I'm just going to read it. Greetings to the 12 tribes. I don't even know if I'm going to read the topics, the little headlines there. Probably not. It's just a letter. Didn't have sections. James, a bondservant of God, and of the Lord Jesus Christ.
to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. Greetings.
Hold it like this, a little easier here.
My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. O God. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. For me, it's the best trick in the book, and it's not a tip or whatever. It's the best counsel. We'll read that little bit again. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. It's like, nah, keep bugging him, wisdom, wisdom, but don't doubt that, you know, it's all right. No, we don't have perfect, but you understand it? If you're a theist, pal. Let the lowly brother glory in his exaltation. Let the lowly brother glory in his exaltation. Put the rich in his humiliation. Because as a flower of the field, he will pass away. For no sooner has the sun risen with a burning heat than it withers the grass. Its flower falls, and its beauty appear, its beautiful appearance perishes. So the rich man also will fade away in his pursuits. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then, when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. All right. Desire leads to sin. Sin leads to death. James. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures.
Remember that means.
I think just Christians and all the explanations of exclusionism. So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, for the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God.
Don't tell the Christians, because, you know, we'll kill you, but, or the Muslims, or the Jews, or anyone, or the atheists, too.
So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness an implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. Thoughts and prayers don't matter. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. Do or do not. No thinking in a scene, but don't do it. If anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this. Does that mean he's not living? Pure and undefiled religion before God the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. My brethren, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. Oh, don't tell a Christian. That guy's a Christian. I don't know. That guy's a scumbag. He's an atheist or an agnostic. I don't know. I don't even buy it. He swears. He's not like it. My brethren, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and fine apparel, and there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say to him, you sit here in a good place, and say to the poor man, you stand there or sit here at my footstool, have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brethren, has God not chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Do not the rich oppress you and drag you into the courts? Do they not blaspheme that noble name by which you are called? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty. The law of liberty. And what about bearing false witness against, what about that? If you just do that. Hey, wait a minute. No one's perfect. Jesus saved the adulterer and the adulteress. Let he who is without sin cast first. That ain't it. Grace. They just hate the morality and there's a God who cares about that stuff. Screw you. I hate you. We get the shtick, pal. But you gotta take some responsibility for your actions. Oh, okay. Hey, wait a minute. Lying hypocrite, filth. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder or bear false witness, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. If you're merciful, if you have compassion, empathy, and you help because you have mercy on that person, you're in a position and you have mercy. Mercy implies you have the clout and they don't. And you show mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Now listen very carefully. Faith without works is dead. All right, that's the next topic here. What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him? Thoughts and prayers and faith don't matter. If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, pray you have a good day, right, AD? But you do not give them the things which are needed for the body. What does it profit? Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works, what I do. You believe that there is one God? You believe that there's one God, monotheist one. You do well. Even the demons believe that and tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Dead. Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered Isaac, his son, on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works? Faith was working together with his works. And by works, faith was made perfect. God understands this. Even James understood it. And even Jesus probably explained it to him once or twice. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. You see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. In fact, fervent love for one another is like, pal. Likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. The body without the spirit. Well, you know how people claim you have a soul or a spirit somewhere in that hunk of meat that makes you alive? Not just a brain, but it's connected to the bowel, but the... For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. Now, chapter 3, this is a tough one. But we're almost half done with James here. My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. And for one, it was just one teacher, one rabbi. That's Jesus. We'd have one rabbi. But you understand they have to go out and teach Jesus, right? Yeah, we know all about them, especially these days. The priests, all vomit, everything unclean. Read your Isaiah chapter, whatever that was. My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. Looking at you, seminary guy, you douche. Oh, the spiritual experts, the spirit hogs, all the, whether the dark arts or the light arts or keep your trap shutters. Keep your trap shut, who's teaching. Boogie revelation. ESV, even New King James, whatever, we'll pick it apart and forget love and do not withhold good. Forget it. When I say, I get out Jesus. I don't even think John wrote that. My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. For we all stumble in many things. Everyone, even James. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle the whole body. Indeed, we put bits in horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn the whole body. Look also at ships. Although they are so large and driven by fierce winds, they are turned by a very small rudder, wherever the pilot desires. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things.
See how great a forest a little fire kindles. See how great a forest a little fire kindles. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and creature of the sea, is tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no man can tame the tongue, no woman either, all right? It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the similitude of God, in the image of God. With it we bless our God and our Father, and with it we curse men. Curses upon you, I hate you, who have been made in the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessings and cursing? My brethren, these things ought not be so. These things ought not to be so. Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter from the same opening? Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olives, or a grapevine bear figs? Thus no spring yields both salt water and fresh. This part's cool. This is the wisdom part. Heavenly verse, demonic wisdom, end of chapter 3. Who is wise and understanding among you? How about you, Freemasons, or anyone? How about you, human being? Are you you? Then I'm talking to you. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. That's the truth. Yeah, you do. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. Why would demonic be tied to earthly and sensual? For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality. That one's a Christian. I hate him because I'm in the atheist club, bro. That one's an atheist. I hate him. And without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. The fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. The Lord is peace. God is peace. God is love. These people, they don't understand. No, let's make them understand. Read that again. I won't chime in this time. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show, or let her show, by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Does this mean like you gotta be a little like bent over and like if there are evil oppressors you just have to listen to them? Not once. No, that's how we interpret it. Oh, okay, but you must be special or even a Christian, right? Or whatever yours is, or lack thereof. Dogmatic atheist guy who, yeah, should've. And no constitution, it never existed, right? It's fake. Got it. But you're the resistance or the real, right? Okay, reek. Chapter 4 of 5. Where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure, that war in your members? You lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight in war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your pleasures. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the Scripture says in vain, the Spirit who dwells in us yearns jealously? He gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Doesn't mean you have to hate the one, ain't it, pal? You're not supposed to hate anyone. That ain't it. Love your neighbor, love them. Wait a minute. But that ain't it. Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world, makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think the Scripture says in vain, the Spirit who dwells in us yearns jealously, who dwells in all of us, you're tethered to him. But he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God. Bend a knee, pay the man. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Well, if I say to him, and then double-minded. Yeah, I kind of want to do good sometimes if it suits me, I'll pretend, but then really I did. Double-minded. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Then you'll be happy. Do not speak evil of one another, brethren. He who speaks evil of a brother and judges his brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. That would be Barney, God. Who are you to judge another? Only God judges. You know, Yahweh, you know, Yah, or, you know, Allah, one God. You know, monotheist one. You know, the Exodus one. You know, the God of Abraham. Do not speak evil one another, brethren. He who speaks evil of a brother and judges his brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Just one. That's the omnipotent. Who are you to judge one another? Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city. Spend a year there, buy and sell, and make a profit. Whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. You have no clue. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Man will soon forget, either way. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. God willing, But now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. And you're certain you're so great, we can do that. Well, we know from the past, it dictates. If you got one foot in the past and one in the future, you're pissing all over the present. That's something I learned from, not the Bible, right? But it's smart. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell, and make a profit. Whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. Especially secret boasting. We don't even know. Okay. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. Let's be honest. In this kind, you, pal, it's also a crime, too. You even know that. Something about free speech and oppression. Chapter 5, last one. Not even that long. Come now, you rich, weep and howl for your miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver are corroded. And their corrosion will be a witness against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have heaped up treasure in the last days. Indeed, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, cry out. And the cries of the reapers have reached the ears of the Lord of Sabbath. You have lived on earth in pleasure and luxury. You have fattened your hearts as in a day of slaughter. You have condemned, you have murdered the just. He does not resist you. You have condemned, you have murdered the just. He does not resist you. Therefore, be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until it receives the early and latter rain. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Now, what does he mean by that? Well, in Isaiah, it says, I will pour out my spirit upon them. God's spirit, you know, God's spirit, you know, God. The Lord could mean Jesus. It could mean the Lord, you know, Yahweh. You know, yeah. There's more than one way to, you don't buy it. Do not grumble against one another, brethren, lest you be condemned. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. My brethren, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord as an example of suffering and patience. Indeed, we count them blessed who endure. Doesn't mean you have no say in it. Wait a minute, excuse me? You have heard of the perseverance of Job and seen the end intended by the Lord, that the Lord is very compassionate and merciful. And his work, his mighty work, is strange. But above all, my brethren, do not swear by heaven or by earth or with any other oath. Doesn't mean cuss. It's like, I swear to God, I swear. Jesus said that first. Who's teaching him here? Barth. But above all, my brethren, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or with any other oath. But let your yes be yes and your no be no, lest you fall into judgment. Only dishonest people need to do that. I usually say I speak true. That's different. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing psalms. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let him pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. But if there's shysters who are not publican, then don't even go near them. Go to the doctor or pray for yourself. These days, are you kidding me? It'd be my advice, my two cents. But if you understand, no, this guy, well, let him pray with you. It doesn't mean just let him look at his heart. Call him up on the phone. Say, you know, call her up, whatever. But you understand, the spirit of holy, oh yes, oh. If they want anything back from it, if they want power over your mind, pal, you know by their fruits. Their works. They don't want, but they're green. There's a lot of that going around the Christian community, just for one, right? Christian community is the worst offender, I even understand. Anyway. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much.
But you do that in secret while you...
No, like publicly. Go on CNN and say, you know what, we screwed up. Even the secular version, we screwed up. But now we can fix it. Spirit of truth stuff.
No, and Brian, oh, okay, Reek.
Anything to lawyer it, right? The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth, the truth, you know, and someone turns him back. Let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his ways will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. And you can't do that by, you can lead the horse to water. You cannot make it drink. That ain't it. Just live your life. Just do your best. You even heard what God said to Elijah, right? Listen, they're probably not going to look at, they don't even listen to me. But, oh, that's how he, that's the end of the, that's the very last thing he writes. Brethren, if any among you wander from the truth and someone turns him back, let him or her know that he or her who turns a sinner from the error of their ways will save his soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. That's James. It's all he writes. Brother of Jesus. That one letter. And I apologize I went through it like that, but I will post it so you can read it as well. Savvy? I usually post it like an hour or two after. Alrighty? Maybe a song, maybe not, who knows? That's it. Mazel tov. Whatever. God bless you all. I hope you're safe. And that concludes episode 14, part 2 of Wisdom. Wisdom of James, exclusively. Just the one letter. Much love, and really, really much love. Enjoy your day. And I guess it's around, what, 9:57 Eastern Standard Time here on whatever day it is here, 7th April. So I'll have this up in about 2 hours or so. No shoot for that. Right around 12:30, whatever. But if you're watching this, sorry. Anywho, I'm out. Goodbye. Where's on to? Which one's on to? Is this on to? No, and is that on to? Who knows? All right, we're out. See ya.